Hello students, myself Professor Ankur, I welcome all of you for the gate theory session of analog circuits. Today we are going to cover an important topic in BJT. So we are starting with BJT part 3 and the topic that we are going to cover today is BJT cue point and stability. So let's go for the topic. So in the previous session, we have seen a transistor under common base and common emitter configuration. So here we are having a graph of IC versus VCE. So this graph is corresponding to the output characteristics of common emitter. So here, when I talk about the regions of operation, I can define the regions of operation into three types: saturation region, active region, and cutoff region. So you can see a blue line indicator. So it's a small region which is rising straight towards the upside, going towards IC max. So that region is corresponding to the saturation region. And the lower region here below the red marking line is basically corresponding to the cutoff region. And the remaining part of the entire characteristics is corresponding to the active region. Normally, when I try to interpret the junction behavior for all three regions, I can say that during saturation, both the junctions, base emitter and base collector, are forward bias. In the active region, base emitter junction is forward bias, base collector junction is reverse bias, and in the cutoff region, both base emitter and base collector are basically reverse bias. So how we are trying to use this with respect to the applications? So whenever we talk about the operating region as a cutoff region, we can use it, matlab, we can use the device as a switching device, and here the device will remain in the off state. And whenever we talk about saturation region, the device can be used in the on state, so it will work like a closed switch. And whenever we talk about the linear region, the device will be in the mode of amplification. So it will satisfy the relation IC is equal to beta times IB in the amplification region. And the value of VCE will be ranging between the VC sat value and the V supply value. Now, what do you mean by an operating point? So transistor is basically a device that can be used for amplification. As you are aware, with respect to the regions of operation, can be used as a switch when you operate in either saturation or cutoff. So now here we are trying to use the concept of amplification. So for that, the device needs to be biased. So whenever the device will be biased, we have to ensure that the base emitter junction is forward bias and the base collector junction is reverse bias. So accordingly, you're going to get one particular value of current IC and one particular value of voltage VCE. The combination of that point corresponding to the X and the Y axis, where the Y axis is your collector current and the X axis is VC voltage. Since the device is biased for an operation with the help of a DC battery, you will get a fixed value of current and a voltage. So that combination of current and voltage will be defined as the quiescent point or the bias point or the operating point of the transistor. So when I try to modify the arrangement for different relations between current and voltages, you will keep on getting multiple points. And when you join all possible points, you get a line, and that line is called as a load line. So basically the quiescent point is one of the points of the load line. So it is as good as one combination of current and voltage at which the device is being operated. That is basically defined as a operating point or a quiescent point. So as I've said, the operating point of the transistor is the value of VCEQ and ICQ of BJT at which the device is operated using various biasing method. The collection of all the operating points is defined as a DC load line. So let's try to understand more with respect to a circuit. So here we are taking a circuitry. So on the left hand side figure, you can see a transistor with two batteries, and you can see one resistance for the input side defined as RB and the other resistance for the output side defined as RC. So when I apply the KVL to the input loop, the input loop equation will be VCC minus IBRB minus VBE is equal to zero. And when I apply the KVL to the output loop, you will get VCC minus ICRC minus VCE is equal to zero. So you are getting VCC is equal to ICRC plus VCE. You can rearrange this entire equation of the output side in the form of IC is equal to something times VCE plus a constant. So that will give you a relation in the form of Y equal to MX plus C. So eventually you will land up at the load line equation. So a small understanding from this, if you want a load line equation, you just have to make KVL to the output loop and rearrange in the form of output parameter relation, you get a DC load line equation. And now we have to use a small concept of mathematics. To draw a line on a graph, we require 2 points, x-intercept and y-intercept. So to get the x-intercept, we need to make the y parameter zero. And to get the y-intercept, we need to make the x parameter zero. So in the relation VCC minus ICRC minus VC is equal to zero, once I put VC equal to zero, you will get the value of IC as VCC by RC that corresponds to the topmost point on the y-axis, that is under the sad behavior. And when I make my value of IC equal to zero, you will get VCE equal to VCC, implies the maximum voltage between the collector and the emitter can go till the value of VCC. So the lower limit is zero and the max limit is VCC. So once you get these 2 points, we need to join them. We get a load line. That load line is basically defined as a DC load line. And when you solve the circuitry with respect to the values given in the form of data, where we are aware of the battery values and the combination of resistances, we will get one particular value of IC and VC. And once you put it on the graph, you will get a combination. That combination will be defined as Q point. So now the Q point is basically with respect to a DC conditions. Whenever we give an AC signal, the AC signal will try to get superimposed on the DC level. So with that logic, if I'm trying to have a variation of that Q point position, you will see an impact of output getting clipped off. So what is the impact? If you see the left hand side figure, the Q point is tried to be shifted closer to the saturation region. So since the Q point is moving on the upper side, the AC signal will shift out of the range and will get clipped from the top region. So the current as well as the voltage wave is getting clipped from the top side. Now here, if you observe the right hand side figure, you can easily see when the Q point shifts on the lower side, you will get the clipping effect of the current on the lower side. So it's a very simple understanding. The most important point here is the current and the voltage graph will have an inverse relation. Now, why we are having that inverse relation? Because when I see the load line equation with respect to the previous circuitry, it will be IC is equal to minus 1 upon RC times VCE plus VCC by RC. So the minus sign indicates that the slope is negative, implies that whenever we talk about rise in VCE, you will get a fall. You'll get an impact of fall in IC. So that's a relation between the current and the voltage. So when you see the current's graph, they will look in phase, whereas you see the current and the voltage graph, they will look out of phase. So now when you see the clipping effect for the left-hand side figure happens on the top side for the current and the bottom side for the voltage. And for the right-hand side figure, the clipping effect happens for right hand side here, bottom side for current and the top side for the voltage. Now this is all happening because of the fluctuation of Q point. So what do we interpret from the entire situation? The entire situation gives you only simple information that if you want energy to be preserved and we don't want any clipping or distortion in the output, we have to ensure that the waveforms of currents and voltages will lie within the operating range of the device. And that is possible only when the best possible position of Q point is getting selected. So the best possible position for Q point will be closer to the center. This will ensure, or you can say, you will get optimum results with respect to minimum effect of clipping or distortion in the output. So we don't want actually the cue point to shift, because with the help of the device, the resistors and the batteries, we are trying to fix the value of current and the voltage. In short, we are trying to fix the position of cue point. So once you fix the position of cue point, I don't want that cue point to change. But due to external impacts like variation in temperature or variation of device or any other external interference, the currents and the voltages level of the device will fluctuate. And whenever these parameters fluctuate, you get a variation of cue point. And due to the variation of cue point, we get distortion in the output. So if we want to avoid that logic, we have to ensure that the position of the cue point always remains stable. And that's the reason whenever we discuss the operating point, the cue point, we need to discuss the stability of that cue point along with the operating point. So when I define the stability, I'm defining it in terms of a parameter called as stability factor. So there are three stability factor parameters defined as SICO, SBBE, and S beta. Implies that the stability of cue point is a function of three parameters: the leakage current ICO, the device input voltage VBE, and the device current gain beta. So whenever these parameter fluctuates, there is going to be a result or an impact on the collector current. So we are trying to study the change in collector current with respect to the change in ICO current is defined as SICO. Change in collector current with respect to change in VBE is defined as SVBE. And change in IC with respect to change in beta is defined as S beta. All three parameters are defined independently in their notations as stability factor. And why these factors are important? Because the denominator functions are having the right to change due to either device variations or due to external impacts, temperature changes. But we don't want the numerator function to actually get a change. The collector current should remain stable. I don't want a device current to fluctuate always. So if that is the case, I want the value of delta IZ to be close to zero as possible. So that is the basic understanding of the parameter defined as stability factor. The value of stability factor should be closer to zero. If the stability factor value is very small, then the stability of the circuitry is very high. So it is basically like an inverse relation. Don't misinterpret it by a stability factor is a factor that improves stability. That's a false statement. The stability factor is a factor to interpret the stability of the circuitry. So we want the stability factor to be as low as possible. So when I want to achieve the cue point position, I want to bias the transistor using different biasing methods. So overall, if I try to interpret the transistor, I'm having four types of biasing method: a fixed bias method, emitter bias method, collector to base bias method, and voltage divider or potential divider bias method. So in all, we are having four biasing methods, and we are going to go for these topics in the upcoming session. Thank you.